inner network, life, love, light. What is life? Life is communion between light and body. Body represents subconscious and unconscious. Verily, human being operates through organs of perception and organs of action. When you are interacting with the person, it is the organs of perception through which the information comes to you. It is processed. It is put in a space where it is processed. And then through the organs of action, it is disseminated as your response, as your reaction. So part of this life begins in darkness. Then comes love. What is love? Love is twilight. Little bit of darkness, little bit of light. Darkness has not disappeared. Light has not come to its full swing. We have not evolved out of the quicksand of emotions. This is love in the middle. It can become a bridge between life and light. But that's a journey. And then when love completely evolves and comes in the light, it becomes light. This is inner network. Life, light, life, love, and light. Along with the organs of perception and action, human body needs five elements of the nature. These are fire, ether, sky, these five elements that yoga talks about. But there is a physical aspect of it. Water is the physical aspect of water, and water as the quality, salt as the physical aspect and its quality, which is saltishness. This is the subtle aspect. We can see the water, but we cannot see its quality to quench its thirst unless we consume it. This is the subtle aspect. So that makes 20. Five organs of perception, five organs of action, five elements of nature, the physical, five elements, the subtle aspect, 20. Then light, that makes 21. All life, sentient or insentient, begins in darkness. A child is conceived in mother's womb, continues to grow in the darkness. A seed is planted in the womb of the earth, remains there in darkness. Then one day it bursts open its shell and begins its journey upward. Such a tender seed, so much capability it has in its bosom, that it has the capability to burst open the hard surface of the earth and comes onto the surface. According to spirituality, the darkness has two aspects, and it represents the subconscious and unconscious. When we are not living our life out of consciousness, each circumstance and situation that is stored either in the subconscious or unconscious part of our being. And this happens both at individual level and as well as cosmic level. There is a difference between the two. You have your individual unconsciousness, and then when you come in contact with another person who have similar habits also, so your unconsciousness gets accentuated, increased. As an individual, you would not like to thief anything. But if there is a riot, and everybody is involved in that, you may engage in an activity that you would not do on an individual. This is collective unconsciousness and collective subconsciousness. Light represents the conscious and superconscious both at individual and cosmic level. However, life as an overall entity is darkness. One simply groups, guesses, and goes on stumbling. Love is midway, a twilight. A little darkness and a little bit of light. The dawn has not come. The meeting of light and life, a bridge. And the third state is that of pure light. Everything disappears in the vastness of the light. Not even you are found. Not even a drop merges in the ocean and loses its identity. No more identified as a drop of Hudson or Thames or Ganges or Nile. Simply it becomes oshtik. You dissolve in that light. You become that light. Life lives in the past and the future. Love lives in the present. And light, these are the two aspects of time. Light is non-temporal. It knows nothing of time. It is eternal. Beyond time and space, we talk of light. Do we really understand light when we talk of light? A lighted object does not mean light. Light that I speak of is awareness. A great Sufi poet, Mirza Ghalib, says, "Aate hain yeh mazami khayal mein ghaib se." When the light descends, where does the light come? It activates your mind. Thought process begins. Then thought becomes understanding. Understanding reaches at the body level through the organs of perception and action, and you interact in the outer world of objects and beings. It is in Bhagavad Gita, the fourth chapter, the first verse, Arjun asked Krishna, "Can you tell me something about this yoga?" Krishna says, "I taught this yoga first to sun, and from sun it went to Manu. Manu, according to Hindu mythology, is the lawgiver. The first man, Manu. And then from there it came to Ikshvaku. Ikshvaku refers to the desire level. You have to toil for that, the soil." So Arjun verily asks, "You are now, how did you teach this yoga to sun?" Sun represents light. The moment sun is on the horizon, birds begin to chirp, the buds begin to open and spread their beauty and fragrance. There is light all around. The streets that were dead begins alive once again. There is a movement. Entire life begins the moment that sunlight begins to fall. The bud that has encased its beauty and fragrance in its bosom, with that light it begins to open its petals, to spread its beauty and fragrance. Then it reaches at the level of the mind. It activates the memory. It activates the intelligence. And Adi Shankar says in one of the sutras, which is known as Nirvana Shatkam, the sutras of salvation. Mano Buddha Ahankar Chittani Naham. I am neither the mind, nor the storehouse of the memory, nor intelligence, nor the ego sense. I am neither of this. But these are the four corners through which we interact into the world of objects and beings. Together these create a realm of subconscious and unconscious, or we call it negativities. Either you are operating through ego or a storehouse of the memory or your own intelligence which lacks the light. Man, mind, buddhi, intellect, ahankar, ego sense, chit, the storehouse of the memory. I am neither of this. Light has descended at the mind level. It activates your thoughts. Thoughts, now where these thoughts are coming from? Because light has fallen. It is coming from an unknown source. I am speaking. You are listening to me. I am also listening to me. Because the words are mine. The voice is mine, but the light, the force that activates these words, gives it a meaning, is not mine. I have become a channel to allow that light to come through the mind and flow in the form of thoughts. Then it will guide my actions. I will see a different perspective when I listen to you or anyone. When I come across a particular circumstance and situation, my perspective will be different. This is at the level of desires. You look at the desires in a totally different manner. These are the three aspects. I gave it to the sun first, from sun it came to manu, the mind, then to the desire level, at the body. Body operates through the organs of action and perception. The eyes see something, a form is made, and this form is carried to that inner space, which is the meditation. And it brings out the information that this particular flower that you are seeing is a rose flower. Memory comes and gives you the indication that yes, it is a rose flower, and I confirm that. Light that I speak of is awareness. It is the source of illumination. In the cosmos, sun is considered as the sole source of light. Light is wisdom. Light is knowing. Light is awareness. Light is mindfulness. Light is true. Light is reality. Light is the way. Unknown and unknowable communes with you in the moments of awareness. Only when you are available, when your Wi-Fi is connected. Otherwise the message will be in escrow. Until you can reach to the nearest source that you can borrow somebody's device and try to unravel that message which has been meant for you and you alone and nobody else, it remains in escrow. I have said again and again, knowledge is not essential for knowing anything, or the state of mindfulness, or the light or awareness. Here I speak of conceptual knowledge. Then what are the other instruments one can use to grasp reality? One can reach the ultimate through direct experience. All studies and speculations are based on concepts. In conceptualizing, we divide the reality into places, into pieces, and consider these as independent of one another. The way we conceive of things is called imagination and discriminating intellect. We are not aliens nor as a strangers join. We are bound to each other by a causeless force. There is a power within that knows beyond our knowings. On the dumb bosom of this oblivious globe, although as unknown beings we seem to meet, we are not aliens, nor as strangers join, bound to each other by a causeless force. The faculty that directly experiences reality without passing through the concept is called non-discriminating wisdom. This wisdom is the outcome of meditation. All other is discriminating intellect. Experience helps the student in the process. Light is verily a realization first, and when it descends to the level of mind, it manifests as understanding. Then you are guided by such understanding each finite moment when you interact with objects and beings. The sun represents three things: life, love, light. All three come from sun. With that, a new pilgrimage begins. But life is just the beginning of a great pilgrimage. It is not the end. And those who think it is an end miss the whole point of life. They have taken the manure for the flowers. It could have produced great flowers, but manure itself is not flower. It has the capability, the energy to allow the flower to blossom. It can become the opportunity to grow great roses. It can create the basic necessary condition, but still it is not rose itself. And if you go on collecting manure, your house one day will begin to stink. That is what happens. People who become too greedy for life, they forget. They are collecting the manure. Their life begins to stink out of greed, out of possessiveness, out of violence. Their life cannot ever have any fragrance because they have completely forgotten the whole point. The manure is good if it is used as a manure. Certainly, it cannot be collected, and if it is used, the same energy that becomes to defile and desecrate the place can become a great fragrance. It is transformed. Life should not be taken for granted. 99.9% of people take it as if it is the end. These are the worldly people, and these are the people who have made the earth ugly. These are the mundane, the mediocre people. They become politicians, they become great holders, and become exploiters. Their whole experience seems to be directed towards one thing: how to survive. But if you ask them for what, there is no answer. They live in a vicious cycle. They live to survive, and if you ask them, why do you want to live? They want to live more. And what are you going to do by living more? Just to make an effort to survive. They move in circles. Live long, make more efforts to survive. Survive long so that they can live long. This is the basic dimension of life. Life is much more than this. Life has infinite dimensions embedded in it. Only you have to learn the art of exploiting this. The moment you are on this voyage of exploring various dimensions of life, you are on an inner voyage, inward journey begins. But this is utter stupidity. That is why you will feel stupidity spread on the face of the people all over the world. No sign of intelligence, because they have not taken even the first step towards being intelligent. And what are the other dimensions of life? Certainly the other dimensions of life are love and light. Life lived without love and light is horizon, like swimming. You are on the surface of the water, covering up a distance, moving from A to B, B to C, but you're remaining on the surface. You have not been touched by the depth of the water. Life lived without any love and light is horizontal. It is only one dimensional. Only there, if you plot the graph, it is X and Y ordinates. There is no other dimension. It becomes boring and flat. It cannot have any poetry in it. It is impossible to have any celebration in it. At the most, one can live from one entertainment to another entertainment. This is what we see all around. All its joys are superficial. They cannot even be called joys. At the most, we can call these as pleasures. A pleasure is something that keeps you occupied pleasantly for a certain period of time, and again you are bored. You have entered into a love life, continues for a while, you feel bored. Then you need another new toy to play with so that you can remain occupied. Love means introducing a new dimension into your life. It is dimension of feeling, the dimension of heart. Feeling is a state when there is no thought in your mind. Only awareness is, or there is witnessing alone. The being is there. Soon you will come out of deep waters. This is what Nanak calls it as bhav or feeling, a state of samadhi. And samadhi, or the ultimate in meditation, is the state that happens when you drown in feelings. This is the point of no return. Then such feeling continues. You are now one with that feeling. This is not diving still. Instead, it is drowning. You are fluid-like. The ice has melted. It has become fluid-like. It begins to flow from a higher altitude to the lower. The movement has begun. Still, we are far away. If you want to attain to the infinite horizon, then you have to allow that ice that has melted to evaporate. You are like one made of salt, and salt has now dissolved in the water, leaving no trace of you. And whenever anyone will taste the water, certainly he will get the taste. You do not have a separate identity. In feeling, you are separate. Sometimes you get the glimpses of oneness. In samadhi, the ultimate in meditation, you are one. The glimpse now becomes eternal. Nanak says, when his feeling is so intense and valuable, then what can be said of samadhi? If life is the goal and end unto itself, then one lives through head, and only the head. One lives through calculation, through arithmetic. One lives only motivated towards profit. One lives in the past and in the future, knows nothing of the present, because thinking can have no contact with the present. Either it is memory of the past or planning of the future that has not yet born. The moment feeling is introduced, the moment the dimension of heart comes in, and something immensely beautiful starts happening, you start becoming aware of this very moment. Past and present lose its significance, because love knows only one time, and that is present, this very moment. It is spontaneous. It is non-calculative. It is not arithmetic. It is poetry. It is not mathematics. It is music. Though unseen, it is the realized truth. Certainly it pronounces aesthetic beauties. Love relates. Is the way to relate to sentient and insentient being. Love is awareness. Love is way of life. The manure has been consumed, and out of that the beauty and fragrance is emanating. Love is understanding. Love is your being. Love is the way to manifest your being. Certainly love cannot be reduced to relationship, but we do that. Relationship is something finished. Relationship is numb. A full stop has come. The honeymoon is over. Now it is no more joyful. No more enthusiasm is there. It is all over. This is what your so-called marriage, so-called love relationship is there. Love downgraded to a relationship. But love is more than that. The journey of love begins but never stops. It is a continuum. Love's honeymoon begins but never ends. It is like a novel. It is not like a novel that starts at a certain point and ends at a certain point. It is not a flower that you smell and throw it away. It is not like a book that you once read it and close it. It is an ongoing phenomenon. Lovers end, love continues. It is a continuum. Love is a woe, not a numb, but we replace the beauty of relating to that of relationship. This is the agony and misery of man. To relate in love is insecure. To relate through love is difficult. To relate through love needs tremendous courage, understanding and meditativeness, and relationship is security. Relationship has a certainty. Now you can have joys. Now you can have some depth in your being. Now you do not live only on the horizontal plane. Instead, a vertical plane has been added to you. It has entered into your being. You live now two-dimensional. Life becomes rich. Yet still there is a third dimension. The moment you introduce meditation, your life starts moving towards light. Meditation is prelude to light. The first state called life is very dark. The last stage called light, absolute light, as if inner sun has risen, not the outer. Thousand suns have risen. It is exactly what all the mystics of the world have been saying, that when they reach to their innermost core, a sun bursts forth far brighter than the outer sun that we see in the sky. Life is darkness. One simply gropes, guesses and stumbles. Love is the midway. Twilight, a little bit of darkness and a little bit of light, the meeting of light and life, a bridge. And the third state is pure light. Everything disappears in that light. Not even you are found. You dissolve in that light. You become that. Life lives in the past and future. Love lives in the present. Light is non-temporal. It knows nothing of time. It is eternal. The sun represents all these three dimensions. Search for the inner sun. Let first life become involved as love and then meditation. First let your heart start functioning and then be a witness to the head and heart both. Then you live the three dimensions. That is the symbol of Trinity, be it Hindu symbol of Trinity or Christian or anything else, or the sign. The figure has been of immense importance down the ages for single reason that ultimately everything comes to number three. You can call it Trinity, three faces of God. You can call it Trinity, but one thing is certain, that as you go deeper, only three are left. And those three are not separate from one another. They are aspects of one phenomenon. Hindus call it Satyam, Shivam, Sundaram. That which is truth, that is eternal. And that which is eternal is beauty. Truth, eternity, and beauty. Or Sat Chit Anand, truth. When you have experienced truth, consciousness is born. And when truth and consciousness merges into one another, bliss is the outcome. Satyam Shivam Sundaram. Sat Chit Anand. My effort is to give you a vast open sky of understanding. Love and light in myriad ways, so you can float in the vastness of the space that religion calls as God. Life, love and light are three faces that we see around.